I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower, Jesus tells his disciples today. Growing all over Palestine, vines were a metaphor for Israel in the scriptures. In Psalm 80, which is a prayer for deliverance from national enemies, we find a communal lament on the fall of the Northern Kingdom in 722 BC. Restore us, O God of hosts, let your face shine that we may be saved, the psalmist cries. You brought a vine out of Egypt. You drove out the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it. It took deep root and filled the land. The mountains were covered with its shade, the mighty cedars with its branches. It sent out its branches to the sea and its shoots to the river. Why then have you broken down its walls so that all who pass the way pluck its fruit? The boar from the forest ravages it, and all that move in the field feed on it. Turn again, O God of hosts, look down from heaven and see. Have regard for this vine, the stock that your right hand planted. The prophet Jeremiah presented a vision of a vine that had grown wild to demonstrate how Israel had not succeeded in fulfilling its purpose. The word of the Lord came to Jeremiah saying, I planted you as a choice vine from the purest stock. How then did you degenerate and become a wild vine? And Jesus tells his disciples that his followers are like branches on a vine that have no spiritual life independent of the vine. The life of the disciples flows into them from the source, from Christ, from the one who lives for the life of those attached branches. In today's reading from the Gospel according to John, we are presented with a picture of God's great judgment, of which there is no escape. Jesus tells us, whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. In Matthew's gospel, Jesus tells a parable of God as a landowner who has planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. And there are rules of behavior for those of us who work in God's vineyard. The great rule in John's gospel is that mutual abiding brings life and productivity to the disciples. To disengage from that mutual abiding, to disconnect from the body of Christ, is to withdraw and expire, to wither like a dead branch, to cease bearing much fruit. Today we are reminded that the servants of the Lord, the prophets of Israel, continually summon us to bring God good fruit. Again and again, God called us to return. In today's Eucharistic prayer, Mother Dorothy will soon address the ruler of the universe, saying, through prophets and sages, you revealed your righteous law. The prophets and sages continually summon people like you and me to give God good fruit, but they were met with beatings and stoning and death. The prophets and sages remind us that we are tenants in God's vineyard. We gather here every Sunday morning to offer thanks for the fruits of the vineyard. We celebrate the Eucharist, the principal act of Christian worship. Eucharist is a Greek word meaning thanksgiving. At harvest time, the first fruits offering was an offering required by God of the Israelites. The first fruits offering is mentioned several times in the Hebrew Bible. In the book of Exodus, we read, the choicest of the first fruits of your ground you shall bring into the house of the Lord your God. In the book of Proverbs, we read, Honor the Lord with your substance and with the first fruits of all your produce. Then your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will be bursting with wine. The most comprehensive passage about the first fruits offering is found in chapter 6 of the book of Deuteronomy, where we read that the purpose of the first fruits was to acknowledge how God took the Israelites down to Egypt, multiplied their number, released them, and gave them the land of Canaan for an inheritance. God told the Israelites that the first fruits offering was to be given in thanks for a land with fine large cities that you did not build, houses filled with all sorts of goods that you did not fill, hewn cisterns that you did not hew, vineyards and olive groves that you did not plant. In the majority of appearances, first fruits is associated with thanks to God for bringing the Israelites out of the house of slavery. You and I have been delivered from slavery too. We have been brought out of slavery by the God of all power, who sent his only Son to open for us the way of freedom and peace. What should have been for us a celebration of the first fruit of God, the Father's gift of his only Son, of the true vine, descended into crucifixion. St. John the Apostle and Evangelist tells us that Jesus said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. St. John wants us to know in Eastertide that it is finished. Jesus completed everything that the Father sent him to do. He opened for us the way of freedom and peace. Jesus' mission is complete, but our mission is not. We are still being called, like St. Philip, by an angel of the Lord who says, "Get up and go down a wilderness road. Get up and go. Spread the good news that we are continually being made new, that creation is continually being restored, and that every day we are called to life anew in Christ." We've been singing here during this Easter season, "The powers of death have done their worst, but Christ their legions hath dispersed." A legion was the principal division in the Roman army. The Greek word legion means to gather. The devil's gathered legionnaires, dispersed by Christ, came prepared for battle, equipped with large rectangular shields, helmets with neck guards and cheek pieces, and body armor of leather, mail, and segmented steel, with short swords and daggers and heavy spears and light javelins. Yet, as we have been singing during this Eastertide, "The three sad days are quickly sped. He rises victorious from the dead." But in fact, St. Paul tells the Corinthians, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. The term first fruits is used in the New Testament as a metaphor to mean those who experience God's blessing. St. Paul writes to the Thessalonians that God chose you as the first fruits for salvation through sanctification by the Spirit and through belief in the truth. In the book of Isaiah, God asks his people, "What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes?" God has planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. And now God expects it to yield grapes, not wild grapes. God expects a good crop from his people. The vine grower approaches the vineyard. I know this, I lived in Northern California, with a knife. And every single branch is thoroughly cut. Some are cut away. They are cut away because they are fruitless. Some are pruned. They are pruned in order to be made more fruitful. In order to yield a good crop, we need to press on like St. Paul. We need to take St. Paul's advice. Finally, beloved, St. Paul tells the Philippians, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. As tenants of the vineyard, we have one goal. Our goal is to care lovingly for God's vineyard so that it will yield in abundance. We know that the inevitable judgment comes at harvest time. We know that the proof comes in the yield. But today we are reminded also of the truth that Jesus is the true vine and our Father is the vine grower. God has a vineyard. No matter where it is, no matter who tends it, no matter how much energy or effort must be expended to achieve an abundant harvest, we have a choice to make. Every day, we make a choice to work for God or to work against God. In front of you is the Red Book of Common Prayer. Reach for it and open it. Open it to the reading for an order of Compline on page 132. There you will find the advice from the first letter of Peter. Be sober, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith. I wasn't going to say this because I'm being recorded, but I'm going to say it anyway. It is not popular in America anymore to believe that. And it is not popular in the Episcopal Church to preach that. But especially if you are a young person today, don't listen to anyone who tells you that is not true. I have lost two cousins to drug addiction. Two. They will not marry. They will not grow old. They will not have kids. They are gone. Don't believe anyone who tells you that is not true. The truth is that if we are not sober, if we are not watchful, if we are not firm in our faith, if we don't tend that vineyard well, one day we will wake up to spiritual emptiness. The good news is that we can choose to tend that vineyard well. knowing that with our energy and our effort, the vineyard will grow and live, and so will we. The harvest will be perfect, and so will we, if we let the Son of God shine in our hearts, if we let the Son of God into the lives we lead. And joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, we must ask the Son of God to give us water for that vineyard. Those of us, I'm one of us, those of us who live in a land with fine large cities that we did not build, houses filled with all sorts of goods that we did not fill, hewn cisterns that we did not hew, vineyards and olive groves that we did not plant, must accept Christ's invitation in John's gospel, where Christ says to his branches, "The water that I will give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." Amen.